Hey, how many of you know there really isn't any such thing as Christian music? Music, folks, is the tune. It's what we grew up to. It's what we like. It is the words that make it Christian. So sometimes in churches, we get a little upset because the music sounds a little different than what we used to and what we like. But if those words are scriptural, they may bring somebody into church that wouldn't normally come. And that's why we play such a variety of music here. I am trying to find a reggae band. If you know one, let me know, because I love Christian reggae. But I also love it when Jimmy comes up here and sings those sacred hymns. I love it when B-Shock. And I didn't think I'd ever like that, but I'm liking B-Shock. I have to tell you. And I really like some of the rock and roll. And sometimes we like to, like we did this morning, like we did last week, is jumble up and write our own lyrics to tunes that you're already familiar with. Because we know that if we do that, then I've lost my glasses. They're right with my keys, I'm assuming. If y'all didn't hear yesterday, I went to the gym, locked my keys in the car, Margaret had to come rescue me. I actually bought an extra set of keys because I do that so often. But I locked that key. I locked those keys in the car along with my other keys, so for 2 cents. Anyway, and also I do want to give you complete transparency. I do not take a salary. However, I do get a tank of gas a week. And occasionally, an electric bill gets paid at our house or something like that. My wife's a waitress, so we've been about 3 years trying to build this church up. And the board has actually given me permission to take a little bit of a housing salary, which most of the time I do not take. We're reinvesting back in the church because I know the payoff is going to be there one day. So I do want complete transparency. It's not that I never take anything, but I take very little. And what I can put into the church financially through our tithes and offerings is considerably more than what I ever take. Again, one of the things I want to let you know is that we are very, very careful. We are very, very good stewards with the money you've entrusted us with. We pray about it. We ask God to increase it. And it has been amazing. It has been amazing what God has done over the last 2 years, and some opportunities I believe are going to be coming up shortly that are even let us to spread God's word and be what God calls us to be a little bit more. And what I've learned over the years, and this really has nothing to do with today's message, is those that are talking about others are normally the ones that see others doing something that they know they should be doing. And we are evangelizing, we are spreading the Great Commission, where things are happening here that only God can do. There have been hearts and lives transformed, and many of you here know that we have helped greatly in our community because of the blessings that you all have come with us. So I used to worry about those type of things, but when I realized that most of the time it was by the people, rather than trying to get out and do what somebody else is doing, what this church is doing, that it's easier to tear somebody else down than it is to build yourself up. So we pray for them. We bless them. We're all part of one ecumenical body, one body of Christ. That's sort of what we're going to be talking about today as well. But I'm also not anybody's judge. I leave that up to God. I just do what I think He calls me to do, and I do try to stay in prayer that we go through His will. So anyway, good morning. How y'all doing?
Good.
For those of you who may not know me, my name is Rob Welch, and I have a great privilege of being the pastor here at the Odyssey Church. It's just amazing to sit back sometimes. It's such an encouragement to see what all that would be impossible in man's eyes that God keeps going through the people that come here on a regular basis and really through people around the United States who support our ministry that don't even know who we are. And I really hope and pray that you've already begun to experience this wonderful Lord, this great God, our Savior, this morning. And that you could sort of experience His love through those that are here. And, you know, I don't think church should be a place where you come and you just, a place that you come on Sunday mornings. I think you should like the experience. I think you should enjoy church. I think that church should be fun. Experience should be great, but we should never compromise God's word. So we do speak the full counsel of God's word. We speak about His love often, His grace and His mercy often, as we should, and occasionally we speak about His wrath as too. Because I don't think you can understand God's grace without understanding is wrath. You can't understand his love. You can't understand what saved means until you know what you're saved from. And there's a lot of churches that I think you can go to, but I truly don't think, I hope you already can experience this, that you can find a more loving church to go to. The people here that come week after week are incredible. We welcome you if this is your first time. We ask you to come and be part of our family. And as you can see, we've got a pretty diverse crowd here. And that's what I like about the church too, is a lot of churches that are sort of thickish, and I'm not talking bad about them, but we've all experienced it. And everybody's like, acts like, talks like, and here there's such diversity. And this is what God has called his church to be, his body of Christ. And that's one of the reasons I'm just so excited about this new series we're getting ready to do, which is I Love My Church. Because I know, and I've been praying what it's going to mean to me, and I've been praying what it's going to mean to you, but ultimately what it's going to mean to our community as well. Hopefully we're going to reach out and we're going to show them the love of Jesus. And in this, you know, what I've figured out is we may not be able to change the entire world, but what we can do is change the world around us and change the world of the people around us. Which if you think of it, about throwing a rock in the river, the ripple effect just keeps going out and out. So who knows? Maybe God will use us to have this great revival that not only changes our lives and the people around us and the people in Shelbyville, but spread out everywhere. That's what our prayer is. So that's what we're going to be talking about over the next several weeks, is what this local church, what this local body of Christ is really all about, and how we can have the impact that God calls us to have, the impact through each of our own lives, through the people that we love, through our family lives, and the impact that we can have in our community. And somebody may be wondering, why in the world would you name the series I Love My Church? And one of the reasons I think we've done that, and one of the reasons that we're trying to put all this together, and the series itself is not original, the graphics aren't, but the messages are very original. They're what God has given me as I spoke and I studied. And one of the reasons I think it's so important that we talk about this is because the church is the nearest and dearest thing to God's heart. And God actually proved it. He demonstrated that. He sent his son into this world, into this sin-filled world, because he loved you, because he loved you, loved me, loved each one of us so much that he would send his one and only son to give him sacrificially to come into this world, that he would live this sinless life, that he would die an innocent death on a cross, to be placed in a tomb, and then 3 days later, to be raised or resurrected back to life again. And he did all this so that we could have forgiveness of our sins, so that we could be redeemed for what we've done wrong, so that we could have a relationship with the living God. And sometimes I wonder at the awe of it. This is a God that created everything seen and unseen. And the more we know about science, the more we see the unseen, right? I mean, everything in this room is made of particles, atoms that aren't seen. And God creates this universe that goes on for infinity, and there's things that the strongest telescopes will never have, never be able to see, will never see, and yet he created everything. And this God, that created everything, that can do all that, that created me, created you, knew us before we were in our mother's womb, said, I want a relationship with you because I am in love with you. And when you think about it, it will truly change your life. God did this. God sent his son so we could have forgiveness of our sins and we could have this gift of eternal life and the assurance of heaven. And when we realize all that God did for us, all that Jesus did for us, and we realize that it was all about us, it's all about you and it's all about me. When you realize all this, it's about his church here on earth, his body, his just to redeem us. Man, you're just beginning to realize. You're just beginning to realize how much God is in love with you. Not how much he loves everybody, which he does, but how much he loves each one of you individually. He knows you so well. He loves you so much. He says, I can count the hairs on everywhere on your head. Easier for some than others, as some pastors say, but still. Now, some of the greatest statements of God's loving nature toward you and towards me, towards his church, were written by a man who had experienced God's love in a very unique way. He was a man who knew Jesus, walked with Jesus, spent time with Jesus when he walked here on earth, one of his closest disciples. And although we have this love of God that's communicated all the way through the scriptures, from Genesis to Revelation, from cover to cover, from the first book to the last book, when we get to the Gospels, and the Gospels are just simply history of Jesus' life that were written by a man named Mark, a man named John, and Matthew, and Luke, what we see is God not just telling us about his love, but through this history, these historical accounts and these witnesses, we see God demonstrating his love in a very, very special way. And John is one of those people that got to see that. And sometimes John, this man named John, even referred to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. Now, in John, he also writes not only the Gospel of John, but he writes three other letters, what we now know as the 1 John, 2 John, and 3 John. And these letters were written to the churches of the time, and they have been, in my opinion, just miraculously miraculously kept around for almost 2,000 years, so that as he writes to his church, it wasn't his church 2,000 years ago, those letters have been preserved for his church today, which means they're for us today, too. So you have John, who's written 1 and 2 John, 3 John, and the Gospel of John, and he wrote one other book. Because in those four books that I just mentioned, he talks nothing, almost the main theme, the central theme of every letter, is God's love for his people. But John, like the Odyssey Church, never leaves out God's wrath. He writes also the book of Revelation, where we see God's wrath coming together in end times. But the amazing thing, some people study prophecy like that and they get very concerned. You should never get concerned, because it's simply to do one thing, is to point us towards Jesus. And as we read the book of Revelation, what we see is God is pointing us towards Jesus and his ultimate victory over evil, over sin, and his victory, not just for himself, for his glory, but so again, we're redeemed. So John, like the Odyssey Church, doesn't leave out God's wrath. And John actually can describe this one who is love. I mean, what John tells us is that it's not about this little C church, it's about this big C church. And John says, I've actually proven to you and I'm showing you how much God is in love with you. And he can do this meticulously because John had experienced this in a very special way, in a powerful and compelling way. Now, if you have your Bibles this morning, and I'm turning them to the Gospel of John, we're going to be looking at his Gospel. We're going to be looking specifically at John 13, 34 through 35. That's Gospel of John 13, 34 through 35. And if you don't have a Bible, please pick one up there at the door. They're free. They're for you. We love to give those away. And if you like, in here, the translation I normally read from, which is a New Living Translation, which is not only an accurate translation, but a very easy to read translation, please again pick one up. Or if you have a friend you'd like to take one to, please. Because we know there's a lot of books that can change you, but there's only one that can transform you, and that is the Word of God. And I think you should bring your Bibles to church, because you can write them and you can take notes in them and you can highlight them. And God doesn't disapprove of any of that. You know, some people say, well, I would never do that. That's God's work. You should do it. Because I think God actually looks down from heaven and smiles upon us when we do that, because he knows you're more apt to apply this to your life the more you're involved in it. The more you're involved with God's Word, the more you're going to apply it to his life. And without application, there is not going to be any transformation. So love, when we talk about this love is truly the most powerful motivator in the world. And you know, we turn on the news today, we might say that hate is the most powerful motivator in the world. I mean, we're seeing what's happening down in Charlotte, North Carolina. We see the terrorism worldwide. But really, the fact is, you can't. It's going to take away from you. You can't hate something without loving something else. So truly, love is the most powerful motivator in the world. But so often in our humanness, we have this tendency to love like we are loved, right? When we don't feel loved, or somebody does something against us that's not in love, we react by sometimes not a very loving manner. You know, it seems like the way we love hinges upon how the people around us love us as well. The less we're loved, the less likely we are to love. the opposite is true as well. The more somebody pours into you, the more that somebody loves you, the more that they do for you, the more in love with them you become. That's not the love that Jesus calls us to. In fact, there's a statement that says that it's easy to love those that love you, but to love your enemies as well. We find these important words of John, and they're written, these words were spoken by Jesus, recorded by the witness John, and they're written and spoken, or at least spoken, on the night before Jesus would die on the cross. So really, these are some of his last instructions in his earthly body before he goes to the cross. So anytime you look at somebody's last words, usually they are very, very important. And this is no different. In just a couple of hours, Jesus is going to be falsely accused against God, against the Jewish nation. He's going to be illegally arrested. He's going to put unfairly in trial. He's going to be criminally condemned. He's going to be severely whipped and beaten beyond recognition. And then he's going to be hung on a cross to die. These are some of Jesus' last words and last instructions. So we know they're important. John starts out in these two verses, John 13 through 34, by saying this. So now, I am giving you a new commandment. Love each other. Just as I have loved you. You should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. Now, I'm thinking, and again, I have a vivid imagination. I learn more visually than I do probably any other way. So I had this picture in my mind of all them sitting around this campfire. Jesus knows about what had happened. They're not sure, but they've had the Last Supper. They know something's on the horizon. And they're like, man, Jesus must be under a lot of stress right now. Because he's saying to give you this new command to love. Love's all through the writings of Moses. Love's all through the New Testament. In fact, what's made Jesus so controversial at this time is that he has done nothing but love his people. And he's telling us to give a new command to love. But don't you think the next day they would have been thinking about it? Because I think this is what Jesus meant when he said that. Jesus is saying, love people like Jesus loves people, and Jesus thinks people are to God. Love people like Jesus loves people, and Jesus thinks people are to God. And I begin to imagine in my mind what they must have been thinking when they saw Jesus on that cross and began to absorb his words from the night before. Man, Jesus loved us when we were in the middle of our sin. Jesus loved me when I was on that fishing boat and I was cussing and I wasn't even looking at God. Jesus loved me when I was in Levi's. Jesus was loving me when I was stealing from his people. And I think they were probably thinking the same thing the Apostle Paul wrote when he wrote these words. But God showed a great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, all the disciples had to think, was Jesus really serious about this? Jesus loved us. Even when we messed things up, when we got it wrong, he still loved us. Jesus loved us. He would encourage us when we got it wrong. And then he would encourage us more when we got it right. They probably thought back and said, you know, Jesus loved us when we really, really messed things up. When we would listen to his teachings and we got it wrong. In today's sermon, we say our doctrine was wrong. Jesus loved us. Well, he even loved the one that was stealing from his treasury. He was God. He had to know he was stealing, and he loved him anyway. This man who would ultimately betray him, he served and he washed his feet. Is Jesus really serious? Is that how he wants us to love? I mean, this man was going to be the catalyst to his death on the cross. I think about the times that I've denied him and the times that I've betrayed him, and he still loved me. He never stopped loving me, no matter what I did. Jesus loved me so much he put his welfare above my welfare. And look at him now. He's getting the punishment that I deserve. I should be up there on that cross. Jesus loves us despite all the things we've done wrong, all the things that hurt him, all the things that hurt God the Father. He still loved us enough to die for us. Not just sacrifice things, he sacrificed his very life. He loves us so much, he poured himself out. He's poured himself out entirely and sacrificially. He loves us so much, he's taking our pain and our suffering, our sins, and he's taking his Father's wrath. Jesus loved us when we were unlovable. Could this really be what Jesus meant when he said, I'm giving you this new commandment to love each other? Just as I have loved you, you should love each other. He's hanging on a cross for me. Is that what he means? And he says, your love for one another will be the proof to the world that you are my disciple. Is that how the world will know me? They're not gonna know me because how much I give to the church. The world's not gonna know I'm a disciple of Jesus if I go to church 2 or 3 times a week. The world won't know me as a disciple if I read the Bible and memorize and I quote scripture and verses. Jesus says, no. All that's good, you should do all those things. How you love each other is how you're going to be known as my disciple. We think to ourselves, is that really what Jesus meant? And the fact is, it's exactly what he meant. We are to love people like Jesus loved people, and Jesus thought people were to die for. We're to love the people that not like us. We're to go out into our communities and love the people that talk like us, look like us, act like us. Talk and love the people around us in the middle of their sin. We don't wait for them to get cleaned up and then say, okay, now you can come to church. Love them right where they are. Jesus started right where they were. Jesus walks up to Levi at his tax collector. He's in the middle of his sin. We're to love people we don't even know. Don't even know us. We're to love people in our workplaces. We're to love people in our communities. And we're to love them when they mess things up. Even when we know they're messed up, we're still to love them. We need to encourage them when they get it right. We need to love them when they get them wrong. We need to love them enough to teach God's wrath. But let them know that God is a God of love. That God is a God who is not just loving everybody, but in love with you individually. And that you don't have to fear him. You don't have to fear his power because he is love. Love isn't something that God does. It's something that God is. The same John tells us that God is love. Jesus wants us to love people like he loved. He washed the people that were around him, even when they were wrong. He would wash their filthy feet. He would wash them. And we're to do the same thing. We're to wash people when they're physically dirty and when they're spiritually dirty. Not just when they do what we want to do. Not just when they love us the way we want them to love. Love people like Jesus loved you. Love the people that hurt you. People that hurt me, the people who said things and spread rumors, love them anyway. Love the people who have betrayed you, even to the point of great personal loss. Love the ones that were scoundrels like that Judas guy was. Maybe they've done something to you. Maybe they've done something to your loved one. Jesus says, I still want you to love them. Now, there's a difference between reconciliation and loving and forgiving somebody. Okay, I want to make that clear. But you love people by pouring yourself out for them. Love them even if it means you have to suffer them. Even if you have to love them in the middle of their sins. Even if it costs you something of value. Even if you have to put your life and your things on hold to love them. Love them anyway. In other words, God is saying, love people, even the people that are unlovable. Love people like Jesus loved people. Not how the world tells you to love people. Not how your friends, your family, your loved ones may love you. But love people like Jesus loved you. And if you do, then the world will know that you are a true disciple, that you're something more than just a Christian. In other words, Jesus said, I'm giving you this new commandment. And I want to stress that because it says commandment. And these are the words of Jesus. This isn't a suggestion. You know, I think you should go out into the world and love people. He said, this is commandment. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, and tomorrow I'm going to show you how much I love you because I'm going to be stretched out on a cross and I'm going to be bloody and beaten and dying for you. That's how I want you to love each other. And you think to yourself, can I do this? How can I love people like that so the world will know that I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ, that I'm something more than somebody who just calls them a Christian. I'm a disciple. I can't do that. Yeah, you can. You might think to yourself, well, I can't do that. I mean, that was Jesus. He was God. He can do that. Maybe that person over there, they're more spiritual than me. They can do that. God says, no, you can do that too. Now, the truth is, we're all going to get it wrong occasionally. The apostles got it wrong. The disciples got it wrong occasionally when they were walking with Jesus. So God does not expect perfection. I mean, I thank God for His mercy and His grace. And all that, what connects the dots to His mercy and grace is His love. He gives us mercy and He gives us grace because He loves us. He's in love with us. But let me suggest to you that we can get it right more often than we get it wrong. Let me suggest to you what I believe are the most important two things that will, if we'll do them, we'll go closer to God and we will be able to love people like Jesus loved people. Both of these things are found throughout the Gospels, but specifically I'm looking at the Gospel of Matthew this morning, because Matthew had experienced God's love in a unique way too. Jesus came to him in the middle of his sin and made an invitation that He makes to you and me. He still makes today. He said, you know, Matthew, or Levi as he was known at that time, why don't you just come follow me and see if I am who I claim to be. Just follow me and see. You don't have to make your decision right now. Just keep coming to church, keep reading your Bible, keep following me, and see if I am who I claim to be. And I claim to be God. And that's exactly what Matthew did. He began to follow Jesus Christ. And he eventually came to believe that Jesus was exactly who he said he was, to such a degree that Matthew would die a death like Jesus died, a martyr's death. He would be killed for his belief in Jesus. He didn't believe Jesus was truly who he said he was when he first followed Jesus, but he came to believe that. And now we have the account of Jesus' life, which is the first book of our New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew. And Matthew records what's called the Great Commandment. You know, Matthew was there one day when Jesus was in a crowd, and one of the guys come up and said, Jesus. And this is probably the most important question you could ask Jesus, because we all want to know the answer to this. Jesus, what is the most important law? What is the most important commandment? Which is the most important commandment of Moses? And I think about it. You know, I've had to answer that same question in my life, because I think to myself, you know, with all the rules in the Bible, with all the commandments, with all the words of the prophets, I know I can't follow all that. You know, maybe there'll be some hope for me if I can just figure out one or two. You know, and I can follow one or two. I can't follow. At that time, I think it was 571 different laws that they had to have. My number might be off there, but it was a lot. It was over 500. And they're like, I can't follow all. There's no way. Jesus comes along and he says, let me narrow it down. Okay, Moses gave you 10 laws, Pharisees got you up to 561. Let me narrow it down for you so you can know. And he gives us answers that's so simple, yet so difficult at the same time. He tells us it's all about love. It's Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 through 40. And Jesus says, you must love your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Everything in God's Word, everything from this cover to this cover, everything from Genesis to Revelation, everything in this book, everything that Moses wrote, everything the prophets wrote, everything Jesus said, everything God said, everything you believe the Holy Spirit said, everything hinges on two things. Loving God, loving people. He said, if you just get those two things right, everything else will be accomplished. The greatest commandment is simply to love. Love God, love people, love God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and love people like you love yourself. And every other rule, everything else that God said, everything the prophet said, everything Jesus said, will be accomplished. So to love Jesus, or to love people like Jesus loved people, the first thing you have to have is a great commitment to the great commandment. You have to have a great commitment to the great commandment, and that should lead you to a great commitment to the great commission. You have to have a great commitment to the great commandment, which should lead you to a great commitment to the great commission. And Matthew records that as well. He records it in the last chapter of his book. He records it in his closing verses. Jesus has died. He's been raised back to life. And now he's about to ascend back into heaven for the first time. Or to sit at the right hand of the Father. I'm sorry. Now, if you're not a churchgoer, if you don't quite believe the Bible and all is completely accurate, that may sound sort of strange to you, and I understand that. You know, a guy was dead, and now he's alive, and now he's going to go back to heaven or ascend back to heaven. I understand. But what I want you to know, what I want you to understand is, this is a historical event that was recorded by the witnesses who saw it. This is not a made-up story. This was recorded by the witnesses. And there wasn't just one or two witnesses. There was over 500 people that saw Jesus Christ dead and then saw him alive. So this was confirmed historical fact that the witnesses wrote down. And it says, Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey my commands that I have given you. And you be sure of this, I am with you always until the end of the age. How will the world know? How will your family know? How will the people around you know that you are more than a Christian, that you are a true disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ? It will not be by your words. It will be by your actions. They'll know you're a disciple of Jesus Christ. They'll know that you love God with all your heart, all your mind, and all your soul, if you will love people like Jesus loved people. But in order to do that, you have to have a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission. Picture this in your mind. Look in your mind's eye and imagine the impact we would have as a church if each person in here says, I love my church. I love my God. If each person who calls herself a Christian had a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, can you imagine if just the people in here, how the Odyssey Church would become a great church? It would become a great church that people love attend. If just the people in here decided to make up their minds, that's where it starts, right between your ears. Make up your mind that you're going to make a great commitment to the great commandment and to the great commission, and we can't help but become, the result will be a great church that people love to attend. But what a promise. Look at the promise, Jesus says. I don't think we can. In fact, I know we can't. We can't do it on our own. We can't be this loving person that God wants us to be. But Jesus makes us an incredible promise. He says, no matter where you go, no matter what you do, I'm going to go there with you, and I'm going to help you do it. Doesn't matter where you go or what you do, I'm going to be there with you to give you my power, which has been given to me by the authority of my Father. Now, that doesn't mean it's going to be easy. I won't tell you that. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy. It doesn't mean you don't have to do anything. But what it does mean, that you have God's word of God's presence and God's power. God's power to do what you can't do on your own. Jesus said, when you put your faith and trust in me, when you put your faith and trust instead in me instead of yourself, then I'm going to give you my presence and my power so that you can make this great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission. He said, not only am I going to go with you, I am going to reside in you. I'm going to take up residence in your heart. And I'm going to be there all the way until the end of the ages, which means he's going to be there for all eternity. I mean, you think of that. What a promise. What a promise of God. I've been given all authority in heaven and earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this. I am with you always, even to the end of age. If you make a great commitment to the great commandment and a great commitment to the great commission, not only will you have God's presence, but you'll have his power too. And we can have the presence and the power of God at our disposal at all times. The promise of his presence, of God to work in us and through us, with the promise of the power of God to overcome any circumstances in your life and come out on the other side in victory. No matter what it is, you have God's promise of his power and his presence, so that we can ultimately fulfill God's greater purpose, which is bringing the hope of Jesus Christ to a lost and hurting and dying world. And he knows we can't love people like Jesus loves people. So he goes with us wherever we go, and he resides in us, and he does this because he knows, and we know, if we make this commitment, this great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, then we will become a great church people love to attend. The Odyssey Church, this local body of Christ, will become a great church people love to attend. It'll have a positive impact on the lives of the people around us. The people not only in our church, but the people in our family, the people in our lives, the people out in the Shelbyville community and in the surrounding areas, in Georgetown, in Millsboro, in Frankfort, in Shelbyville. Not just the people that attend, but the people around us. And why? Because we will be known as the disciples of Jesus Christ. We'll love people like Jesus loved people, in all their messes, and in all their hurts, and in all their sins. Why will the Odyssey Church be a place that people will say and not be ashamed to say, I love my church? Because you know, and I know, it is not about sticks and bricks. It's about loving God and loving people. The Odyssey Church is not about the Odyssey Church. It's not about sticks and bricks. It's about loving God and loving people. That's why I love our church. That's why I love the Odyssey Church. Because I know our church don't think it's about our church. You all know, and I know you know, that it's about loving God and loving people. So when I say I love my church, it's the Big C Church. Yes, I love the Odyssey Church. I love what we're doing here. But I love being part of the body of Christ. Woo! It's not about sticks and bricks. It's about loving God with all our hearts, and all our minds, and all our souls. And loving people like Jesus loved people, and Jesus thought people were to die for. A great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission is what makes the Odyssey Church a great church people love to attend. And I'm telling you, I love my church. So, over the next couple weeks, we're going to be learning something about the kind of church that God calls us to be. The kind of church that God calls the Odyssey Church to be and the Big C Church to be, and become what God has called us to be, to make a difference in people's lives, the life of others, the life of the community, the life of our own eyes. And my prayer is, and I would ask that you become your prayer as well, is that we do this by teaching all of us. And by all of us, I mean me as well, because I'm part of all of us. By teaching us to love people as Jesus loved people. By making a great commitment to the great commandment and a great commitment to the great commission, so we'll become the great church that God calls us to be. We'll be the church that people love to attend because they know it's not about bricks and sticks. They know we're disciples of Jesus Christ because we know it's about loving God and loving people. This has been the vision of the Odyssey Church since before we opened our doors. This has been the vision of the Odyssey Church from day one, to help people find and follow Jesus and lead them into a deeper relationship with God by making it easy for those who seek to find God to find Him, to create experiences and environments where people love to come to church without ever compromising God's Word. Coming to church that people love to attend, because this is what we know. People who know they are loved much, love much. People who know they are loved much, they love much. So we want to learn together to love people through our community, We're going to talk about that next week. So I'm going to tell you, you don't want to miss next week. And if you can't be here next week, because some people drive hours, 3 hours away, and you know, we're sort of worth it, but I don't know if they'll do it. Follow us on YouTube. Follow us on our website. Follow us on our app on your phone. We're going to learn to love people in our community by being relationships with people. See, being in a relationship is more than knowing somebody's name and where they sit on Sunday morning. Being in a relationship means that we go alongside them, that we're connected to each other. Being connected to our community makes sure that nobody has to stand alone. That we stand together because two are stronger than one and three are stronger than two. That's why we had events like we did last week, where we invite our community to come in and come alongside us and get to know us, and we get to know them and eat with us and fellowship with us. Because we want people to be connected to God and His people and His church, which is the nearest and dearest thing to God's heart. So to sort of let the cat out of the bag a little earlier than I intended to as I was putting this together, you know, October 23rd, we're going to have our last cookout of 2016. Now you have to notice carefully what I said. Not last time we're going to meet to eat, okay? But it'll be the last cookout of 2016, and I would like you to start praying about who you can invite in your circle of friends who are very far away from God, so that they can come in here and be very near to us, and we can love them like Jesus would love them, and hopefully they'll grow closer to God. So that's the end of this series, which will be October 23rd. It's on a Sunday immediately after the service. So next week we're going to look at how God wants to love through community, and then we're going to talk about loving God and loving people through serving. See, one of the things you may not realize is you have superpowers. And we're going to talk about your superpowers. Each one of us has been given this miraculous ability, this supernatural empowerment to encourage and to help one another and help people to connect to God. You've got superpowers, and we're going to be talking about them. And then we're going to talk about others through loving by giving. And yes, we're going to be talking about giving, but not giving in the way you might think we're going to be talking about giving. We're not going to be talking about tithes and offerings and some kind of guilt trip on you. I promise you that. We're just going to simply be talking about giving as an indicator of love. And then finally, we're going to wrap everything up with a message on loving by sharing. So love our community, loving in serving, loving in giving, and loving in sharing. The love Jesus wants us to give to others, see, and we get it wrong so much. The love Jesus wants us to have for each other is not meant to be kept inside these walls. It's not meant to be kept inside the Odyssey Church. Our mission field is outside of here. That's where we're supposed to go and love. Yes, we're going to love each other in here. Please don't hesitate that. We gain strength. We encourage each other. But we're to go out in the world and love others. He doesn't want to be kept in the walls of the church. The love we're to have for God and for His people is a love like Jesus' love. It's meant to show the love of Jesus to other people. And sometimes we do that by speaking, but most of the time we can do it by simply loving. Folks, I'm going to tell you something right now. If you aren't sharing it, people ain't buying it. If you ain't sharing it, people ain't buying it. Our life should look like what our mouth is confessing. And we're going to start by inviting our friends and family, our community, those who may be very far away from God, to come and bring bread with us and to fellowship with us, because we know people who know they are loved much, will love much. I mean, you think about it. Isn't that the way that God started this thing we call the church? In the book of Acts, on the day of Pentecost, what we consider in modern times to be the birthday of this church, this body of Christ, Acts chapter 2 says, all the believers devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. The believers devoted themselves to loving people like Jesus loved people, and they did that by reading and knowing God's Word, by making this commitment to the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. And what was the reason all that? The very first megachurch. 3,000 people came to Christ that single day. Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to that church that day. About 3,000 in all. And God continued to add to that church daily. When the disciples loved people like Jesus loved people, when they made a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission, they knew it wasn't about sticks and bricks. They knew it was about loving God and loving people. And when they did, when we do, we become a great church that people love to attend. Because people who know they are loved much, love much. Mother Teresa, most of you know who Mother Teresa is. St. Teresa now is. Made this statement. When you know how much God is in love with you, then you can only live your life radiating that love. See, I don't think on this side of eternity we can even begin to imagine how much God truly is in love with us. But if we want to just get a glimpse of His great love for each one of us, before we can love people like Jesus loved people, we have to realize something. We have to know that Jesus knows every single thing about us. He knows about our secret sins, and He loves us anyway. He knows when we've done wrong. He knows the times that we've denied Him. He knows the time we denied His Father, and He loves us anyway. He knows when we put our needs above the needs of others, when we followed our will and went against His will, when we've been selfish instead of sacrificing, when we've been taking and not giving, when we've been receiving and not serving, and He loves us anyway. He is in love with you. He just doesn't love you. He is in love with you. We can't even begin to know how much God is in love with us until we realize how much God knows about us. The fact that He knows everything about us. We don't realize that God knows everything about us, then we can get fooled into thinking God loves us for the people we are instead of the sinners we really are. Those who are loved much, love much. Jesus knows everything there is to know about you, the good, the bad, the ugly. Now, if you don't know that theme song, go rent the movie. Now I got your attention, okay? I want you to know. I want to catch your attention. I want you to know. I want you to be aware of God's incredible love for you. Because love is the greatest motivator for changing the way we think so we can change the way we act. And that's what the Bible calls repentance. Because God knows, and you know, those who are loved much, love much. God's love. The way we're loved is given to us. And we're not to love others in exchange for some kind of effort that they have put into it. God's love is simply full of His grace and full of His mercy. And Jesus tells us we're to love others the same way as God has loved us. We don't give people grace. We don't give them mercy. We don't give them forgiveness because they have earned it or they put the effort into it. We do it because we want to love people like Jesus loved. We want to love freely. And we're to give God's love to others freely, not in exchange for how they love us. And when you realize, when you begin to realize just how much God is in love with you, you're just starting to relieve, just beginning to realize the tip of the iceberg of how much God is in love with you. He loved you and He loved this church by giving His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, by giving Him sacrificially to die an innocent death on the cross. To be placed in a tomb and 3 days later be raised and resurrected back to life. So me and you could have this relationship with God our Creator through Jesus. If we could just get a hold of that, it would change us. God did this so me and you can know forgiveness for our sins, so we have the gift of eternal life and the assurance of heaven. And when you realize all that God did, all that God loves you, how much God is in love with you, then you'll be like Mother Teresa, and you'll say, when you know how much God is in love with you, then you can only live by radiating that love to others. I'm going to ask Donnie to come up. We'll play some music in the background. I'm going to ask you all, I don't normally do this, and you know that. Probably the first time I've done it in 2 years, but I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet if you're able. I want to end today's service just a little bit differently than I have in the past. And I want to do this because I know people who know they are loved much, loved much. And we can only do this, we can only love like Jesus loved, by realizing how much God loves us, each one of us. individual, how much God is in love with us. And I hope by God's power that somehow today you can realize how much you're loved. So if you will you stand with me? I want us as the Odyssey Church to love people as Jesus loved people. Jesus thought people were to die for. But we can only do this by making a great commitment to the great commandment and the great commission. And if we do, we can't help but become a great church that people love to attend. We can only love people like Jesus loved people by knowing His great love for us. By knowing that it's not about bricks and sticks. It's not about this building. It's not about the Odyssey Church. The love of Jesus Christ is loving God and loving people, because people who know they are loved much, love much. By believing Jesus loved you enough to die on that Roman cross, to know Jesus loved you so much He would sacrifice His life for your life, to love you to such a degree He'd take your punishment, the punishment you deserve, that He would face His Father's wrath, to redeem your life of sin, and that is just the beginning of knowing how much God is in love. God knew we couldn't save ourselves, so He sent His Son to do it for us, to become our Savior. His one and only Son is given to us freely. His love is given to us freely simply by believing Jesus' sacrificial death was for you. And let me tell you, God's love frees you. It frees us to really live. It's not meant to be a burden, to be burdened down by rules and laws. It frees us to live life and to live life more abundantly. It frees us to have victory, not in our power, but through Jesus Christ. We have His promise of His power and His presence to do all the things that we can't do. No matter what's going on in your life right now, you have God's power and you have God's presence, so you can get on the other side and claim victory. You believe Jesus died for you? Let's build a stronger church through loving our community. Be loving by serving, to love by giving, to love by sharing, to love people like Jesus loved people. Let's make up our minds to make a great commitment to the Great Commission and the Great Commandment so that we can become a great church. Not a great Odyssey Church, but a great body of Christ. Because it's not about sticks and bricks. It's about loving God and loving people. It's people who know they are loved much and love them. Let's bow and pray this morning. Let's pray that we can become known as God's disciples. And you know I don't normally do this, but God placed it heavy on my heart this week. With everybody heads bowed and eyes closed, if this is the day you've decided to surrender your will to God's will, if today is decided that you're going to make Jesus Christ not just your Savior, that's the easy part, but your Lord as well. While Connie's playing and all eyes are closed, will you just raise up your hand, please? I'm going to ask you, you know, as I say this prayer, and I'll just repeat it in your heart. Father, I know I've broken your law. Father, I know my sins have separated me from you. Father, I'm truly sorry now, and I want to turn away from my past sinful life. I want to turn towards you. Father, I ask that you forgive me and that you help me. Help me to avoid doing the same thing again. Father, I believe your Son, Jesus Christ, died for my sins. I believe Jesus was resurrected and dead and is alive today, and hears my prayer. So I invite Jesus to become the Lord of my life. I invite Jesus to rule and reign in my heart from this day forth. Please send your Holy Spirit to help me obey you and to do your will for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to thank you all. I praise God with all glory goes to Him. But I want to thank you. And I believe that if you're here today and you've never done that before, God, and you'll spend all eternity with His Son, Jesus Christ. But you can live life now. It's not just about dying and going to heaven. It's about living life now and living it more abundantly and having the inheritance, the same inheritance that God gave His Son. How How will people know that that was a true confession? People know that you're a disciple of Christ. They'll know about how you love each other. Why do I love my church? Because it's not about our church. I think God will look down from heaven, he'll smile, and God is the one who will say, look at the Odyssey church down there. Look at what they're doing. Look at the difference. God says, I love my church. I love the body of Christ. Amen. On earth. So if you can, we're going to ask you to come back next week and we'll talk about loving God through community. And don't forget to start inviting your friends to the 23rd. We're going to have that picnic immediately after the service. And may the blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be among you and within you, wherever you find yourself this week. Thank you for joining us. See you next week. God bless you.